I'd like to try and help moderate questions brought to these folks. I don't know if anybody filled out the little slips like we did before lunch, if we could maybe a couple volunteers to collect those. But honestly, it feels like if we can project from our place and the folks on stage can repeat your question, we can do it that way too. Does that sound okay? All right, so I can start with the one card. We'll go to the audience. It's from Michaela. It says, do you think that Alvin is listening but doesn't know how to respond without upsetting you? After all, he wants to be your protection, but he couldn't help what happened in your childhood.
I'm so hearing. I don't know how to answer that question. Because I don't know why Alvin doesn't listen. Check that. And it's something I've learned now, thinking more about what we're here for, is that I don't know why I feel or think or believe that Alvin's not listening. Because maybe you are listening. So I don't know about the protection thing. I don't know. I'd like to open it up maybe to other folks. Yeah.
Okay. What I meant by that was, I'm going to protect myself. We all have one trick that can extremely, you know, protective. And he's married to an interruption. And what happened in the childhood, it would violate protection. No protection. So is it that it gives person?
Well, I can respond to that statement, I guess, a little bit more, where I just feel like throughout my entire life, nobody's really given me the same space to be able to share like what happened to me and like without making me feel like I need to censor it or I have to feel bad about myself or I should in some way recognize that it was so long ago and it shouldn't be impacting my life today. So I just want to be able, yeah, so even though you weren't there that long ago, you know, you weren't, you know, there for that situation, you can't protect me. I just want to be able to talk about it. So yeah, I don't know. I just saved all that. I really want to hear some questions about Afia.
I would like to hear that too. Just, I wonder if I could offer an idea to the audience. We didn't obviously do any open dialogue training today, but one of the ideas or principles in it when we do a consultation or a role play is that when we invite comments or questions, we tend to think about sort of the process. So it's just an offering to think about if there are questions. Maybe it could be about the process of what you saw versus the content.
Yeah, I really want to, we all got pulled into a story, so we're all concerned about that story, and I think that's really a very human thing. But one of the ways that we got pulled into that story was through open dialogue, and hopefully the ways that we were also pulled into the thoughts around FIA and alternatives to suicide. So I think respecting that story and how it exists for those people is a really important piece, and touch base with them, let them know that you care about them, would also be a really, really important thing to do. I have a question for Sarah that got brought up to me. I wonder if you could speak more about why alternative suicide is more popular than hearing voices in support. The opposite is true in Connecticut.
If anyone took that away from what I said, that's actually not accurate.
what I think in both Alternatives to Suicide and Hearing Voices, what I was trying to say is our Department of Mental Health in Massachusetts has not invested the kind of money in that work. We've had to figure out other funding sources, other ways to go about it, or as I said, the state between SP, so well, we just used some of their money and, you know, didn't necessarily ask permission. And Hearing Voices in Connecticut, your Department of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services made a really intentional push to support Hearing Voices here. So I wouldn't say one is more supported than the other. In fact, I would say Hearing Voices probably has been around for longer, has more roots in Massachusetts than Alternatives to Suicide, in part because, if you go to someone at this point and say, Hear Voices, the reaction is less extreme than it used to. If you go to someone and say, I'm suicidal, there's still a really panic reaction from most people. So it's harder for people to absorb, honestly, still.
So if I could just elaborate on it, because it was my question, and I'm sorry if it's interesting, but it sounds like you're saying almost the same thing.
This weird assumption that someone's ever had a psychiatric diagnosis and they do something violent, that it must be cut me because they had a psychiatric diagnosis, is a huge leap that no one ever questions. And so it's up to all of you in this room, all of us, to be questioning those myths and pushing back. Because again, this idea of control, the people in my life who I've seen do like anything even remotely physically violent, it's usually been when they felt controlled, when they felt pushed. That is what the mental health system does. So we've got to be pushing back against that. On the whole, it hasn't threatened our budget, it hasn't threatened how we function. But we are vulnerable to that if we are not forming a united voice to push back and get some of that misinformation corrected.
I saw the 5 minute a while ago. I said, I'm sure there's 5 minutes going now. Last time I got to stop, I didn't want to see that yet. So, again, I want to thank the folks on stage here. I want to acknowledge the people that have made suggestions to the couple that took part in the open dialogue piece. I actually wish we had time to ask them. For me, it would take until at least tomorrow before I could answer this question, but to reflect on how that process was for them, because I think that would be a great question for us to ask. So I guess I want to offer to them that there have been a lot of expressions of concern and suggestions for where you might take this, but it feels very intimate to me, and I really don't want to. I don't want to bust that privacy piece. So if you really feel inclined, I do suggest that you approach them privately with your thoughts, and if you guys think about this and reflect on it, if there's a way that you can share what the process was for you, and also to Amy and Chris, how different is it doing it on a stage versus in actual practice? I think Ken wanted us to offer that we do have the space for a while. So while we are calling a conclusion to today, I don't know, am I doing that or there are another voice to do that? Okay, there's an announcement? Okay. So I'm going to call a conclusion at least to this panel. You guys can hang around and talk to folks at least until 5 or so because we have the space until that time. And I want to thank you personally for coming out today and lending your ears and thoughts to all of this.
Sorry about the finished word meaning hope. And I believe hope is a very important definition for all of us to have in our lives. Dr. Karen King is in this background as well. But we also, that's what we believe in. We believe in offering that hope to people that we serve.
So I missed a bit about the connections.
Dr. King is.
Oh, cool. Thank you. I was reading all the other interesting questions. Thanks for catching me up. For Ken. Will the VVNU be, the HHS or anywhere be offered again in the future?
Did you put one?
Can you hear me? Now, you're referring to the class that...
I think so, yeah.
...and mutual beliefs. Yeah, it's hopefully our first extension of the conference. The first class actually started Tuesday night in Stokes, and a couple of people here in the audience have attended. It actually was anticipated to be at Hall High School, and my daughter's educating me didn't work sufficiently because I wanted to reassure.
You know, and they started looking together, and then the system found out and was like, no, she can't work, she can only do volunteer work. So.
Thanks for that. I want to acknowledge at this little podium, I hate these things, but this one's really, really helpful right now because there are a ton of little cards on here. I have this really awesome power where I can ask questions or not ask questions. So I just want to let you know that I'm going to try to get to as many as possible. Some of you that are asking really, really specific questions, I really encourage you to hit these people during lunch or sometime when they look like they're breathing.
There's a whole range of possibilities that I think we don't think about. It's just, shall this kid stay or shall they go? And we know that it's like, for a kid, it's like they are being punished, and it's hideously traumatic for both the child and the parents. And so I think policy-wise, systems-wise, we need to be really working on this. And I think this is our whole community responsibility.
Thank you. I want to probably put this to all of you. There are several questions here from your audience asking how they can get involved, how they can become peer bridgers, how they can get involved in advocacy in Connecticut. And I was wondering if any of you would like to speak to that.
I could talk about the concept of peer mentors. A couple of things, Zoe. One, Darren mentioned that Chris is going to be coming at some point in time to Advocacy Unlimited to do training for all of the staff and all of the board. As we talked about this whole morning, myself, and I think for others, we see IPS as a core foundational training for engagement.
Heart and soul of really good clinical practice, really good relationships, but and starting to think about and promote that. We are being invited into many more traditional services to train a wide range of people. So this is there are some philosophical challenges for us with doing this. But I think starting just in terms of resourcing and do we focus on people who have lived experience and all that sort of thing. But I really want to support and celebrate the people who are working in clinical roles, who are really wanting to get on board with this because I think this is starting to change the culture and this is what we need to be promoting.
Also dreaming and wondering. So what if those persons who had experiences and services and so on, who now have moved on and recovered, your word was called back. And she used the expression of an army, may not be the best word, but the sense that there's so many people out there who have had experiences who might want to give back. So just a quick story, I was mentioning to a friend who confided in me about her experiences, and she says, what are you working on? I said, I told her a little bit about this, and then she asked me more, and then I started asking her, when I told her about this, she then confided in me about her experiences. So I said, well, I actually was working in a non-medical, non-clinical field, and told her about her experiences, and said to me, when I told her about, well, what if you had some training, what if we did offer a day or two, and so on and so forth, about the idea of being helpful to others who are struggling as you might have years ago. And she floored me, and she said, she looked at me with some degree of astonishment and said, my God, in a minute, and I'll get you six more, is what she said. So that idea started to germinate. This is attractive to people because it's basic stuff, basic human stuff.
I also want to offer that this is happening all around the world, and especially in Europe. A lot of professionals are starting interior support systems. So when they find folks of like minds that are trying to affect change in similar or the same systems, they're getting together and they're talking about it, and they're talking about it in ways that make sense to them with their own language and with their own, you know, local colloquialisms. And I would really, really suggest that you do that. If you really want to affect change where you're at, find like minds, find a consensus around what pieces need to change, and start that dialogue within the agencies that you're working in. And you kind of draw that kind of energy to you, and that'll be your advocacy. I got the stop sign, dude. All right. So I'm going to read this one instead because I think it's a really, really lovely way to end. I just want to thank you all for your passion and work, and a call to speak to your representatives and vote your conscience and your mind and your intellect in the upcoming elections. Thank you very much. Thank you guys all. Instructions for lunch because we're a little bit